Okay, can somebody confirm if you can see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Now it's visible.
Yeah.
Okay, so the last time we went over course outline and we went through some basic definitions of matrices, matrix multiplication, matrix addition, so on. Then we started discussing vector spaces, and in particular we discussed about linear combinations. Let's check my network here. Okay, just a second. I'm going to cut out for a second while I switch networks. Yeah, so we were discussing about linear combinations, and in particular we discussed about linear independence. Linear
Sir,
independence.
I'm able to see the screen.
Can somebody else confirm if you're able to see the screen?
So we can see the screen, sir.
Okay. So yes. Maybe. Yes. Yeah, in your case, if you can't see the screen, then just drop off and join again. You will be able to see the screen. Okay, so okay, good. So linear independence is a very, very central concept to matrix theory and linear algebra. And so I'll just reiterate that a set of vectors are linearly independent if the only linear combination of this set of vectors that gives you the zero vector is the all zero combination, that is all the coefficients must be equal to zero. That's the only way you can reach the all zero vector. Then we say that that set of vectors are linearly independent, otherwise they are linearly dependent. That means that there is a non-trivial linear combination of those vectors where some of the coefficients are non-zero, but which when added together with that weighted combination gives you the zero vector. So today we'll discuss many related concepts, specifically basis, dimension, and last time somebody asked me about linear transformations. When I was telling you that linear transformations are actually equivalent to matrices and matrices are equivalent to linear transformations. So the question was, how do we define what is a linear transformation, which then is related to a matrix? I'm going to talk about that. Then I'll talk about some fundamental subspaces associated with linear transformations or matrices. And if time permits, we will also discuss about the notion of the rank of a matrix. Okay, now to recall, we say that a set of vectors, if you remember, we just put down the last thing we discussed the last time on the previous class. So a set of vectors v1 v2 up to vn span a vector space v if of v1 through vn is equal to v. That means that every v, every vector in capital V can be written as a linear combination of v1 through vn. So basis. So a set of vectors v1 through vk is said to be a basis for a vector space V if it's both linearly independent and spans the set V. So in this case, we call this a spanning set. vector space V if it is both linearly independent and a spanning set. So some comments about the basis are in order. First of all, the basis is not unique. You can define many different bases for a particular vector space. And every V in this set, spanning set V, can be, every V in this vector space capital V can be uniquely written as a linear combination of the bases. Obviously, this is not true if you add or delete vectors from the basis. If you add vectors to the basis, there are more than one way in which you can represent a vector that belongs to the vector space. If you delete vectors from the basis, there are points in V which cannot be represented as a linear combination of the remaining set. So also every vector space has a basis. And we say that another way to say what I just said is, in fact, there are two popular phrases. A basis is a maximal independent set and a minimal spanning set. So maximal independent set, meaning that this is the maximum number of linearly independent vectors that you can pull out from this vector space V. In other words, if you take a basis and you take any other vector from V and add it to that basis, that set of vectors now becomes linearly dependent. And it's a minimal spanning set in the sense that if you take away any vector from the basis, then it can no longer span the vector space. There will be some points in the vector space which cannot be represented as a linear combination of the remaining set. So another way to say this is that a set of an independent set of vectors in a vector space is a basis if and only if no proper superset of it is linearly independent. Also, a set that spans V is a basis if and only if no proper subset of it still spans the vector space. These are things I've already said. I'm just saying it another way. Okay, now another concept which is related to the basis is that a vector space is said to be finite dimensional if there exists a finite set of vectors in V, which is a basis for V. So in this course, we will completely or exclusively look at finite dimensional vector spaces. If the basis for a vector space does not have a finite number of vectors in it, then we call the vector space infinite dimensional. So for example, if you take the set of all polynomials in one variable, say x, then that is an infinite dimensional vector space, because you can have x squared, x cubed, and so on, going all the way up to infinity. So if you take the set of all polynomials that you can define in x, then this forms a vector space which is infinite dimensional. But like I said, in this course we will focus on the finite dimensional vector space. Most of the results for finite dimensional vector space actually do extend to infinite dimensional vector spaces, but in some cases you'll have to make some extension arguments, which is beyond the scope of this course. So here's one result related to basis. It's called the basis theorem. So what do you think it says? Anybody want to guess, or does anybody know what the basis theorem says?
Sir, the number of the vectors present in the basis is actually the dimension of the vector space.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the theorem. So what it says is that if some basis of a vector space has a finite number of elements, then all bases of the vector space have the same number of elements. And this is called the dimension of the vector space. It's denoted by dim of. Okay. So essentially, if you find a basis for a vector space and I find a basis for a vector space, the basis that you found could be different from the basis that I found, but the number of vectors that you have used to form the basis is going to be exactly the same as the number of vectors I have used to form the basis. So just to illustrate this idea that there could be different bases, but they'll have the same number of vectors. So first of all, if I take the space R to the n, this has dimension how much?
N.
So if I take, for example, the case where n equals 2, then 1, 0, 0, 1, this is one basis, and so is 1, minus 1, and minus 1, 1, and so is 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. All these are bases. They will span R2. And you see that they all have two vectors each.
Sir?
Yes.
The second example is not a basis, right? They are linearly dependent.
Yes.
Okay, now it's a basis. Thank you. Okay, so if I take c to the n, this also has dimension n in the field c. Okay, and it has dimension 2n in the field of real numbers. Of course, if you take this n dimensional real space, this vectors e1, e2 up to en, which are like this over here, where basically ej has 1 in the jth position and 0 everywhere else. This is called the standard basis. Okay, so now let's prove this this result. Okay, so how do we prove a result like this? That if some basis has a finite number of elements, then all bases of the vector space have the same number of elements, and this is called the dimension of the vector space. Okay, so the proof is by contradiction. So suppose there are two, I found one basis and you found a different basis, and they happen to have a different number of elements. So suppose V1 through Vn is one basis and W1 through Wm is a different basis. Of V. And without loss of generality, I can assume that n is less than or equal to m. Otherwise, I can simply switch what I call v and what I call w. So I can assume n is less than or equal to m without loss of generality. So as a first step, so basically this has fewer vectors than this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take this bigger set here and replace one of these vectors with, say, V1. And then I'll replace one other of these vectors with V2 and so on. That's what I'm going to do. So first, we can replace one of the Wi with V1 and still have a basis for V.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead, please.
What is that one? Proof second line, basis of V with log n less than equal to m.
Without loss of generality.
Okay, thank you.
So that's a standard shorthand for without loss of generality. There are many such, as you can see, I tend to use acronyms quite a lot. So if you're confused about any of the acronyms, please feel free to stop me and ask.
Okay.
So why is that true? That's because suppose V1 was equal to alpha 1 W1 plus alpha 2 W2 alpha M Wm. I can always do this because W1 through Wm is a basis for this vector space V, and V1 to Vn are also vectors that sit in V. So if I take V1, it's a vector that's lying in V, And so it can always be represented as a linear combination of W1 through Wm. And obviously, not all these alphas are going to be equal to zero, because if I make all the alphas equal to zero, then the right hand side is zero and the left hand side is zero. So if you're not speaking, please mute your mic. Okay, so this is true. So not all alpha is are zero. So if alpha k is one of the guys who is not zero, then Wk can be then written as 1 over alpha k times v1 minus all the other vectors. So in this series, there is no Wk. Okay, I've skipped Wk and all the other terms are here. So I can just, I'm just rewriting this first equation here. Okay, so basically what this gives us is that, so notice that these are, this is just a linear combination of all the other W's. So I can replace Wk by V1 and still have a basis for this vector space V. So there are two things here. So we can replace Wk by V1 and still span the vector space V. And the second is that this set of vectors that we get, W1, Wk minus 1, V1, Wk plus 1, all the way up to Wm, are still linearly independent. Okay, why is that true? Simple. If you take a linear combination of these and you get 0, and suppose that's a non-trivial linear combination, then all you have to do is to substitute for V1. It's some linear combination of all these W's. And what that will end up showing you is that there is a non-trivial linear combination of W1 through Wm, which gives you the zero vector. And therefore, this set of vectors W1 through Wm are not linearly independent. But that is no, that is, that was one of our starting points, that this is a basis, meaning that this is a linearly independent set that spans V. So you can show by contradiction. Yes, go ahead, please.
So could you repeat the last point of W1, this new basis function being what you just said about it?
So I would like you to try to show it. But what I was saying is it's a simple argument. What you do is you take a linear combination of these vectors, W1 through Wk minus 1, V1, Wk plus 1 through Wm. And you set it equal to zero. Suppose that there is a linear combination of these vectors, which gives you the zero vector. And if that linear combination is a non-trivial linear combination, it means that these vectors are linearly dependent. So you start by saying, suppose it's true that I can take some beta 1 W1 plus etc. to beta m Wm, where there is some beta k which is multiplying V1. And with not all beta I is equal to zero, which gives you the zero vector. Then it, what you do is you substitute for V1 from here. V1 is some non-trivial linear combination of these W's. And you substitute for V1 into that equation involving beta 1 W1 plus etc. up to beta m Wm equal to zero. And you manipulate that equation a little bit and you end up showing that there is a non-trivial linear combination of W1 through Wm that is also giving you the zero vector, which means that W1 through Wm are not linearly independent. But that's a contradiction because we started by assuming that V1 through Vn and W1 through Wm are basis of V. So that's the argument. So you can, so now that you've replaced one of the vectors in the set by V1, think of this as your new basis, and you do the same argument and replace one of these vectors with V2. Okay, now clearly V2 is linearly independent of V1. Okay, so you can use one of the other WIs to replace it. You don't need to use V1 to replace it, because clearly V2, when I write V2 as a linear combination of these vectors here, the coefficient of V1 may or may not be zero, but one of the other coefficients will certainly be non-zero. And it's that coefficient that you use to rewrite it like this, and then say you can replace WK by some WK prime by V2. Is linearly independent of V1. So we can use one of the WIs. So then we can do then V3, V4, and so on. Okay, but unless M equals N, what we'll have then is we'll have a set which has V1 to Vn and some of the WIs. And since V1 to Vn span this vector space V, it means that these WIs can be written as a linear combination of these V1 to Vn, and which means that this new basis that we found is not linearly independent anymore. So there will be some W's left over. But any WI can be expressed as a linear combination of V1 through Vn, since V1 through Vn spans V. So that means that this new set that we have is no longer a linearly independent set, and this leads to a contradiction. Okay, so that's the proof. Any questions?
Yes, sir. Sir, while proceeding with replacing every VI by a WI, you said that if the coefficient of certain wi is zero, to take another wi. But while going from v3 to v4 to vn, if we ran out of the non-zero coefficients, I mean, there is no particular wi left for which its coefficient is non-zero and I can replace it by a v.
Yeah, so that's not possible because, so for example, suppose you've replaced v1, v2 and v3 with some of the wi's. And so now you have a set which has some wi's and it has v1, v2, v3 in it. Now you're looking at replacing v4. V4 is linearly independent of v1, v2 and v3. So you can't express v4 as a linear combination of this set which contains v1, v2, v3 and the rest of the wi's, but with the non-zero coefficients being only in v1, v2 and v3. Because this v4 is linearly independent of v1, v2 and v3. So the coefficients of one of the other wi's has to be non-zero. Is that clear?
Okay.
And that wi okay. can be used to replace. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about, okay, just maybe one remark. I think I've already mentioned this, but a property of a basis is that if you take any vector in the vector space V and express it as a linear combination of the vectors in the basis, that linear combination is unique. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about, this is also something you can show, by the way. What I'm doing right now is really just reviewing some basic concepts from matrix theory that you must have seen in your undergraduate. So I'm not proving all of these results. Once we start discussing the new material or the once we get past all this background material, I will generally try to prove every result that I put down. Okay, so the next topic is linear transforms. So suppose we have U and V. These are two vector spaces over a field F. Then a mapping from U to V is said to be a linear map if two conditions hold. Or a transform if one f of u1 plus u2 equals f of u1 plus f of u2 for all u1, u2 in this first vector space. And the second is that f of lambda u is equal to lambda f of u for all lambda belonging to this field and u belonging to this set u, vector space u. So these are the two conditions that define a linear transform. Often this is written compactly as f of a1 u1 plus a2 u2 is equal to a1 f of u1 plus a2 f of u2 for all a1 a2 in this field f and u1 u2 in this vector space u. But this is just another way of writing it. So you may or may not agree that this is a more compact way. To me, this is a slightly more intuitive way of writing it. Okay, so some properties of a linear transform are that the values of f over on some basis of u completely defines f. Okay, that's because every u in this vector space capital U is a linear combination of the basis, and f is a linear transform. So if you can write it as a linear combination, then if you know what values f takes on the basis, then you can find its value for any other u that belongs to this vector space capital U. Second thing is that 0 always maps to 0. So one way to see it is if you just substitute lambda equals 0 here, you have lambda times f of u, whatever f of u is, this is 0, and lambda times u is always the 0 vector. And so one very important property is that any a in r to the m by n is a linear transform from r to the n to r to the m and vice versa. And another property is that matrix multiplication, this is something I mentioned in the previous class also, matrix multiplication is the corresponds to a composition of linear transforms.
Sir, one doubt. This
yes,
can you hear me? This the previous property you told that the linear transform from Rn to Rm and vice versa. What is meant by that? Vice versa part means Rm to Rm.
No.
I don't understand that.
So that's a good question. So any matrix A is a linear transform from Rn to Rm, and vice versa means that any linear transform from Rn to Rm can be represented as a matrix A.
Okay, okay, thank you.
Sir, can you please, you know, explain that part again? The value taken by F on some basis of U completely determines F.
Okay. So suppose the this U has a basis. U1 through U1. And sub f of un. So suppose I know these n vectors, then any u in capital U as u equal to alpha 1 u1 plus alpha n. We've seen that this representation is unique. There's a unique linear combination which gets you to U when U1 to UN is a basis for this space, capital U. So linearity.
Say that again, please. For me, it is stuck. Nothing is visible after you starting writing into the set. I don't know about others.
Video
stuck. Me too. For me also.
It's not updated.
Let me stop.
Yes, it's now updated.
Okay, my network is fine. So I'm going to share my desktop again. Somebody please confirm when you're able to see my screen.
No, sir.
Yeah, I can see now, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Okay. So by linearity, f of u is f of alpha 1 u1 plus alpha n un, which is equal to alpha 1 f of u1 plus alpha n f of un, which is equal to alpha 1 v1 plus alpha n vn. So this is what I mean by saying that the values taken by f on the basis completely determines f on all vectors in capital U. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, is there any relation between basis of U, basis of V and the function? Suppose if U and V are of same dimension.
Yeah, so that's what I'm going to talk about now. Vector spaces associated with a linear transform. So you might have heard this rank nullity theorem. Okay, and this is closely related to that, so I'm going to talk about that now. Okay, before that, maybe I'll make a couple of remarks. So one thing is that the way I define this linear transform here, it's a transform from U to V, and it satisfies these properties. Now, it's possible that there are some points in V which are not reachable as f of u for any value of u. What I'm trying to say is that the way it's defined here, u and v are two arbitrary vector spaces, and and not every small v in this vector space capital V needs to be is required to be reachable by taking f of u for some u in capital U. Okay, so that is one point. Another point is that, as you can see from here, if U has this basis U1 through UN, and I take V1 through VN, then any U in capital U can be written as a linear combination of these vectors. And so if I consider only the points that can be that have an inverse map in capital U. So as I mentioned, not every point in capital V needs to have an inverse map small u. Okay, but if I only consider the points in capital V that do have an inverse map small u, that you can show is also a vector space. And now that vector space, you can see already that any point in that vector space can be written as a linear combination of V1 to Vn. But now it's not clear that, of course, it's clear that U1 through UN are linearly independent. They're a basis for capital U. But it's not clear that V1 to Vn are going to be linearly independent. Moreover, any V which is reachable from this vector space U can always be written as a linear combination of V1 to Vn. So V1 to Vn certainly span this set of vectors that are reachable from this set U under this linear map F. But this could be an overcomplete set. In other words, it's possible that there's a subset of these vectors which span that space. But it cannot be more than N. So the dimension of the space that can be spanned by this U under this linear map F can be at most N if N is the dimension of U. You cannot increase dimension by using a linear map. But it's possible that you end up decreasing dimension.
So does this mean that the V is need not be a basis?
V1 to Vn need not be a basis for the space spanned by U under this transformation F. Okay. That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay, so the first space associated with the linear transform is what is called the range space or the column space. So now I'm going to refer to these linear transforms as matrices, because this particular thing is easier stated using matrices. Because any matrix can be viewed as a linear transform and any linear transform can be viewed as a matrix, we can also discuss about matrices. So range space which is also known as the column space. So that's defined as R of A, which is the set of all vectors in R to the M. So let me say A is in R to the M by N. Y is equal to AX. X is in R to the N. It's the span of the columns of A. It is a subset of R to the M. Every vector here belongs to R to the M. In fact, it's a vector space. Now, the dimension of the range space of A is less than or equal to min of m and n. Why is that? Because it is a subspace of R to the m, right? It's a subset of R to the m. It's a so it can have dimension at most m. And this matrix A has only n columns. And so if you write y equal to ax with n columns, you can have at most n linearly independent vectors in the span of the columns of A. This dimension of the range space of A is also called what?
Rank of A.
Exactly. Thank you. Okay, so for example, if I have A equal to 1, 2, 3, 5, 4, 3, and 3, 3, 3, then the range space or the column space of A is the set of all linear combinations of any two columns of A. Notice that if I add these two columns and divide by two, I get the third column. So these three columns are not linearly independent. So only two of them are, any two of them are linearly independent. So you can take the first and second, second and third, or first and third, any two columns, and the set of all linear combinations of those two columns is the range space of A, and its dimension is 2. Okay, which in this case is actually strictly smaller than the min of m and n. M is 2, m is 3, and n is also 3 here. This is a map from R to the 3 to R to the 3. And the dimension of, or the rank of this matrix A is 2. So here's a small thing you should do on your own is, actually, maybe I'll say the subspace of R to the n, of R to the m. So in other words, it satisfies those two properties we discussed the previous class. Okay, it's Hotel California. You can never leave. Any two vectors in R of A, if you take their sum, that also belongs to R of A. And if you scale a vector in R of A, that also belongs to R of A. Yes, go ahead.
Sir, I have one small confusion. So given a two pair of vectors with a different dimension, I can always find a matrix A, which will, you know, transform, let's say, vector B to vector A. So, does it mean that, transformation is always linear in nature?
So you're saying that given V1, say, in R to the N,
yeah,
and V2 in R to the M,
yeah,
you can always find A such that V2 equals A V1.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that's correct. So in fact, you can find many such A's. But so what's the point? What is your confusion?
So my confusion is that is transformations always linear in nature?
What this means is that you can find a linear transform that maps V1 to V2. It doesn't mean that way you can map V1 to V2. And secondly,
there can be some non-linear transformation, right?
I don't want to look for that right now. It may not be easy to find a non-linear transform, but Okay, here is an example. Suppose I had v1 equal to 1, 2, 3 and v2 equal to 1, 4, 9. Okay, now I can always define a transform f of v equal to, I'm going to use MATLAB's notation here, dot power 2. What this is doing is it's taking the square of every element in v. This is a nonlinear transform which clearly maps v1 to v2. Okay, so it need not be a linear map.
But at the same time, we can find matrix A as well to do this transformation, right?
Yes. In fact, you can find many such matrices because you only have one constraint. You're giving me one point in R to the N and you're giving one point in R to the M and you're asking me to find a matrix A that will map V1 to V2. Of course, this is going to map other vectors to some other points. But in fact, I can find an A that will map if you give me, say, if you give me a set of vectors in R to the N and another set of vectors in R to the M, I can ask, is it possible to find an A that will map the first set of vectors one by one to the second set of vectors? Okay, so to answer that question is not immediate from what we've discussed so far. So you should keep that question in your mind and revisit it later. So I'll write it here. You can think about it later. So given, say, U1 through UK in R to the N and V1 through VK in R to the M, can we find A in R to the M by N such that VI is equal to A UI, I equal to 1. Okay, so this is a very basic question, but I don't want to answer it right now. It's something to keep in mind and you can revisit it later.
Okay, sir.
There are conditions under which this is possible and under some conditions it's not possible.
Okay.
Okay.
Sir, may I ask a question?
Yes.
Sir, the thing that he told that the element wise square operation that you showed as an example of nonlinear transformation.
Yes.
So, if we want to take any V1 and get to any V2, maintaining the relationship that you told, that element wise square, so it is not possible to find any unique A, right? Because A is not a nonlinear. Means matrix can't be a nonlinear transformation.
Of course, this kind of nonlinear transform, first of all, you cannot express it as multiplying by a matrix A. So this can never be written as AV.
Yes.
Okay, for some matrix A.
Yes, sir. For general case, we can't find any such A.
Correct.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
I think only for given pair of vectors we can do that, but I mean a generic A we cannot find there.
Yes. Okay. So I think we are out of time for today. There are three other important vector spaces associated with a matrix or a linear transform, which I will discuss on Friday. So we'll stop here. And if you have any other questions, please feel free to ask. Yeah, otherwise we'll continue on Friday.